1985, their Powers and Passion album broke into the Billboard Top 100 in the US, which kicked off the band touring the US, Europe, and Japan.
This is the title track from that album. I think titled Power and Passion.
I suppose, I mean, there are many, but for those moments for us were always when you ended up actually doing something with a band that you grew up being a huge fan of. Now, when we were on tour with Bon Jovi in America, this tour was absolutely huge. It was 15,000 seat arenas every single night we were doing on this tour. And then we get a call to be asked to actually play at the Nebworth Festival, which was just opening up again at this point, because the last time it was used was when Led Zeppelin played it in 1979. So Deep Purple have reformed and they're back, and the Nebworth Festival is opening up again, and we were actually asked to do it. So we were on tour in the States. We flew, I remember the journey very well, from Tulsa, Oklahoma to New York, and from New York to London. And we played in front of, it was reported to be 120,000 people at Nebworth that day. That was probably one of the most, because when we walked out on stage, there was just so many Irish flags. You never expected it. That was the thing. It was like, oh my God, I can't believe that I'm seeing this, and knowing that the response you're getting it is actually for Mama's Boys. So all of those little moments when you didn't expect to have that kind of response was always an incredible surprise. So yeah, and then Nebworth was a massive, massive moment in our lives to do that, because it was just like a sea of people, and to see so many Irish flags and the support that we got from Ireland at that point, people that actually travelled to those shows to see us, was just incredible.
My memory is going to Japan and playing. We did it shortly after that there, and it was really funny. It goes, I suppose, maybe to show you how unpretentious we were, because we arrived in a Tokyo airport, right? And there's all these screaming fans. And Tommy and John go to me, God.
Yeah, seriously, I remember stopping and looking to see who had arrived at the airport.
We thought there's a big star has arrived. It must have been on the same flight as us, because they're coming, because all these screaming fans.
And
we actually didn't realise, we actually got there, and we started to think that they're holding our albums.
Yeah.
And we're going, oh my God. There's nobody else on the flight, it's us they're after. And we couldn't, I'll always remember that. Yeah.
This tour, though, was bittersweet for the brothers, as during the Canadian leg, Tommy had a relapse of leukemia, which he'd been treated for as a child.
In the end, actually, what happened was it kind of, in many respects, it was the downfall of the band, because we were on a Canadian tour at the time, weren't we, John, when he became ill again, you know. So that had been the first time in, what, about 10 years that he had actually been ill. So it came back again. And unfortunately, we had to come off the road then.
I remember, this to give you an example of what he was like. I remember we had just come back from, we had noticed that there was something not quite right about him, because Tommy loved life. He absolutely loved being in a rock band. He was without a doubt born to do it. But we noticed that he was sleeping a lot when we were on the tour, and I've even got photographs to this day of where we were flying to Japan, where he's sleeping on the aircraft, and he didn't like to sleep. He wanted to take in every single moment. But anyway, I remember telling my parents about this and saying, we need to have him checked out when we get home. So when we went to Belfast and the doctors came out and actually told us that he had relapsed again, and he's standing there and he looks at me and he goes, what are we going to do about the European tour? I'm like, are you joking me? So he was more concerned about the tour than the news he had just been given and what lay ahead of him, because by this point he was very familiar with his illness and understood it better than he did when he was a kid, and the treatment he'd have to go through again and the procedures.
Yeah.
But he was more concerned about the European leg of the tour. So every night, and this is absolutely true, every night we would call him from wherever we were to ask how he was, and of course he'd always say, oh yeah, no, I'm really good. He's probably like feeling awful, but yeah, he'd go, no, I'm feeling really good. Look at, he goes, I want to do the Irish tour, and we're going, you can. You really can, Tommy, because you've been on this treatment for months now. So we had this drummer called Jim Del Grosso that came in to replace him during that period. And he goes, no, I really want to do it. I said, you can't. I said, you know, you need to practice, you need to rehearse. He goes, no, I've been rehearsing. I said, how can you? You're in the hospital. He goes, no, they found me a wing, a part of the Royal Victoria Hospital that's unused, and they bought me a little kit, which they did. And he was actually in practicing. So he came out. And our first show was at the Savoy in Waterford, I think, from what I can remember. And because our trucks were actually coming in from France, they got delayed at the customs. And by the time we arrived, Pat, I remember, had flown to Dublin to do some interviews. So we arranged to meet in Waterford. And when we got there, we could see that none of the crew were there, none of the trucks were there. So that show got cancelled. So we were secretly kind of pleased because we were worried about Tommy's condition. But anyway, we were doing two nights in Dublin, two nights in Belfast. And he'd done the two Dublin shows. He played out of his skin. He did the two nights in Belfast. And right after the last show, he was rushed straight back in the hospital again. But it's like he came out and did what he wanted to do. And that was Tommy. He loved his drum kit. This is someone who went round, you know, polishing every cymbal and every fingerprint and looking at it and photographing it. And yeah, just really loving his kit. And yeah, he was an amazing drummer, really incredible. It's only when we look back now and examine what he was doing at such a young age, you go, oh my God, because you don't really pay him that much attention to when you're growing up as brothers, it's what it is. But yeah, when you look at it now, you go, he was an amazing musician.
Sadly, while on tour in Italy in 1993, Tommy became ill again and the tour had to be cancelled. The following year, he went under a bone marrow transplant, but tragically, he did not survive. Without Tommy, Pat and John decided that Mama's Boys could not continue without their little brother.
It was a really amazing experience working as three brothers, because I know when most people think about that situation, they go, it must have been really tough working with brothers, but it was actually really incredible. And because we really, there was something that went on between the three of us that was unspoken. We could even go into moments on stage where you just automatically improvise without organising it, but we just felt it was going to happen. So we would carry on, and you know, anyone that ever came into the band at that moment in our career, it would freak them out. They would go, oh my God, how did that happen? It wasn't discussed, it wasn't arranged, and yet we all just would fall into it. So yeah, from that point of view, it always worked very well. So it was like one person actually performing the whole set, literally like that.
So that's why it would be, very difficult for us to do it without him, because he was so, he really was genuinely fantastic. Would have fitted in with any band, anywhere, anytime we wanted, really. He was that good. It was, as I said, it was only when we got a little bit older and he wasn't around that you realised just how good he was, you know. So.
On the first anniversary of Tommy's death, John composed the traditional lament on the low whistle for his brother, and this led to himself and Pat revisiting their traditional Irish music roots and formed a Celtic New Age group called Celtis. In 2003, Pat started another new band, the Pat McManus Band, while John, who still lives in London, pursued other projects. It's been 10 years since the men have played together, and fans across the world have long awaited this reunion. Speaking with the brothers, they are glad that they have the chance to play together again, as their passion and love for music is still as strong today as it was when they first started the band back in the late 1970s.